This is The Big Picture, an official television report of the United States Army, produced for the armed forces and the American people. Now, to show you part of the big picture, here is Master Sergeant Stuart Quain.
Throughout history, nations have sought through treaties and alliances with other nations to maintain their security and remain free from attack. But not until the 20th century did the concept of national security become worldwide in its scope. World Wars I and II and the Korean conflict proved beyond any doubt that when one free nation anywhere is threatened by aggression, the safety of all free nations is ultimately at stake. Today, the United States, keenly aware of its strategic role as a leader in the free world, has allied itself with other nations, dedicated to the preservation of peace and the welfare of mankind. Our big picture cameras today focus on one of the most important of these alliances. As our guest narrator, the distinguished news analyst Edward R. Murrow, tells the story behind NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization.
This is the Palais de Chaillot in Paris, headquarters of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. To this building come ministers from 15 nations of the Atlantic community. They speak different languages, have different cultural backgrounds. The countries they represent vary in size from very small to very large. But here, all distinctions fade. All the languages become one, the language of hope. Why do these nations ally themselves with NATO? Why NATO? And why must this organization continue to exist? Let's go back to the beginning of the story. In May 1945, the war in Europe came to an end. This had been the price of Europe's unpreparedness. But in May 1945, our hard-won peace seemed at last secure. A few days before, Allied forces from the West had joined hands with the Russians from the East. Their statesmen had met cordially at Yalta and at Potsdam. They had agreed that the countries they had occupied should be truly liberated, and that freely elected governments should be set up as soon as possible. Within a few months, the countries of Western Europe and Scandinavia were free and independent. But for the countries occupied by Russia, Stalin had other ideas. Throughout Eastern Europe, elections were held. But the Russians had placed the communists in key government positions and in the secret police. Within a short time, the non-communist leaders had been liquidated. Russia had swallowed up eight European countries without firing another shot, other than those of the execution squads. Great Britain and the United States protested that these countries had been coerced by threat of force and that Russia had broken her treaty. But Russia ignored the protests. Stalin knew that the greater part of the Allied forces had gone home, leaving their arms to rust in the fields of Europe. In the West, men were impatient to be demobilized. The war was finished, and they had other work to do. But the Russians had not demobilized. They retained overwhelmingly the largest force in Europe. The small group of men in the Kremlin had long ago dedicated themselves to the spreading of communism by all possible means. They knew that an army can be used not only to fight wars, it can be used to intimidate. To the south lay two more possible victims, Greece and Turkey. In March 1946, the Russians denounced their treaty with Turkey. They offered to renew it if the Turks would give up part of their territory and allow the Russians to establish bases controlling the Bosphorus and the Dardanelles. The Turks refused. In Greece, the communists had already started civil war. Russia was sending arms to them through the neighboring satellite state to bring bitterness, despair, and death to the Greek people. If Greece and perhaps Turkey were not also to be swallowed up, help had to come from the West. At this crisis, in March 1947, President Truman asked the United States Congress, in an historic speech, to modify its traditional policy of neutrality.
I believe that it must be the policy of the United States to support free peoples who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures.
Only Czechoslovakia, of the countries behind the Iron Curtain, had thus far preserved some independence. After the war, the Russians had had to reckon with the popularity of President Benesch and his foreign secretary, Jan Masaryk. They were liberal-minded men who believed that it was possible to be friends with the communists without succumbing to them. But to the communists, gentleness is weakness. And a country prepared to compromise is a weak country. The machinery for taking over countries had now been perfected. The coup in Czechoslovakia was swifter and more efficient than ever before. Within a week, all opposition was suppressed. There was another victory to celebrate, another victory over freedom. President Benesch was allowed to retire to his country house. He died there, a broken-hearted man. One morning, on the stones under his bedroom window, Jan Masaryk was found dead. Truth had ceased to come out of Czechoslovakia. The nations of Western Europe were forced at last to realize that they must combine to protect their own liberty. 3 weeks after the fall of Czechoslovakia in March 1948, the Brussels Treaty was signed by Great Britain, France, Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands. These five countries pledged themselves to help each other in case of attack. But Western Union, as it was called, was not strong enough to deter the men of the Kremlin from their policy of aggression. In August, Russia decided, on a trumped-up excuse, to cut off the Allied sectors of Berlin from the West. Trains, barges, and road transports were stopped. The United States, Britain, and France were responsible for 2.5 million people in Berlin. Now their food and fuel for their homes and factories could no longer be brought to them overland, unless with armed protection and at the risk of war. It seemed that they, too, must be at the mercy of the Russians. But the governments of the West did not give way. The life of Western Berlin was maintained by air, on a scale never before contemplated in history. Each day, the prestige of the West rose. After 9 anxious months, the Russians lifted the blockade. The policy of standing firm had been vindicated.